Hello, my dear students. Today, under label of first paper, we'll talk about the code of inquiry. My dear students, as you all are aware that we are studying Industrial Dispute Act 1947, which is given unit number 3 for BLLB and BBLLB program. This is video lecture 23rd, and as I told you that today we'll discuss the code of inquiry. Codes of inquiry given under section 6, and in case of the failure of the conciliation proceedings to settle a dispute, the government can appoint a court of inquiry to inquire into any matter connected with or relevant to industrial dispute. So once there is a failure of the conciliation proceedings to settle down a dispute, the government can appoint a court of inquiry, and this may inquire into any matter connected with or relevant to industrial dispute. The court is expected to submit its report within 6 months. The court will submit the report after the inquiry within 6 months, and the court of inquiry may consist of one or more persons to be decided by the appropriate government. So, number one, the court is expected to submit its report within 6 months. And number two, the court of inquiry may consist of one or more persons to be decided by the appropriate government. That whether in this court of inquiry there would be one person or there is a requirement of more than one person, that would be decided by the appropriate government. And the court of inquiry is required to submit its report within a period of 6 months from the commencement of inquiry. So mind it, my dear students, that this 6 month period would be counted from the commencement of the inquiry, and this report is subsequently, or this report will be subsequently published by the government within 30 days of its receipt. So government would be publishing that report within the 30 days time of its receipt. And unlike during the period of conciliation, workers' right to strike, employers' right to lockdown, and employers' right to dismiss the workmen, etc., remain unaffected during the proceedings in a court to inquire. So during the period of conciliation, workers, we have already gone through that, the workers right to strike, employers right to lock out, and employers right to dismiss workmen remain unaffected during the proceedings in a court to inquire. And one more important thing is here, that is the a court of inquiry is different from a board of conciliation. So now, my dear students, we would just try to know that what is the difference between the court of inquiry proceeding and the board of conciliation proceeding. So a court of inquiry is different from a board of conciliation. So how it is different from the board of conciliation? The court of inquiry aims at inquiring into and revealing the causes of an industrial dispute. So court of inquiry will be focusing on, it will be inquiring into and will be revealing the causes of an industrial dispute. While on the other hand, the board of conciliation, the board of conciliation's basic objective is to promote the settlement of an industrial dispute. So the focus of the court of inquiry is into revealing the causes of an industrial dispute. So more focus of the court of inquiry is to gathering the facts or the findings, right? While the focus of the board of conciliation is to promote the settlement of an industrial dispute. And this is the reason a court of inquiry is primarily fact-finding machinery. So the court of inquiry is the primarily known as the fact-finding machinery, while board of conciliation takes care of that how to promote the settlement of the industrial dispute. So this is the, you know, main difference between a court of inquiry and board of conciliation, my dear students. I would revise it once again for your convenience and to make you comprehend in a better way. That court of inquiry is different from the board of conciliation. Why? Because the court of inquiry aims at inquiring into and revealing the causes of industrial dispute. What is the reason of industrial dispute? That fact finding. So we call the court of inquiry as a fact finding machinery also. While the focus of the board of conciliation is on that how to promote the settlement of an industrial dispute, that how to settle down the dispute. And one more thing I would like to hear for your revision purpose, that under section 6 of Industrial Dispute Act 1947, the appropriate government may, as occasion arises, by notification in the official gazette, constitute these court of inquiry for inquiring into any matter appearing to be connected with or relevant to an industrial dispute. So the appropriate government, through notification in the official gazette, will constitute this court of inquiry, and for inquiring into any matter which is, you know, appearing to be connected with or relevant to an industrial dispute. So this is the reason why this appropriate government, through notification in the official gazette, constitute this court of inquiry. And one more thing, that is the as I have already discussed with you, I have told you that a court may consist of one independent person or of such number of independent persons as the appropriate government may think fit, and where the court consists of two or more members. One of them shall be appointed as the chairman. So one independent person of such number of independent persons, right? That court may consist, and if the appropriate government may think fit, and where a court consists of two or more members, one of them shall be appointed as the chairman for this court of inquiry. And a court having the prescribed quorum may act notwithstanding the absence of the chairman or any of its members or any vacancy in its number, provided that if the appropriate government notifies the court that the services of the chairman have ceased to be available, and the court shall not act until a new chairman has been appointed. So this is again one more provision given under this act for court of inquiry. So my dear students, we have just gone through the court of inquiry given under section 6 today, and now I will just like to throw some light on the voluntary arbitration also. But what is voluntary arbitration? So far the voluntary arbitration is concerned, that is given under section 10A, and on failure of the conciliation proceedings, the conciliation officer may persuade the parties to refer the dispute to a voluntary arbitrator. And voluntary arbitration refers to getting the dispute settled through an independent person chosen by the parties involved mutually and voluntarily. So the parties, those who are involved into the dispute, right, they are mutually and voluntarily choosing that independent person
because where any industrial dispute exists or is apprehended, and the employer and the workman, they are agreeing to refer the dispute to the arbitration, they may at any time before the dispute has been referred under Section 10 to a labor court tribunal, labor court or tribunal or national tribunal, by a written agreement, refer the dispute to arbitration, and the reference shall be to such person or persons, and it includes the presiding officer of labor court, tribunal, national tribunal, as an arbitrator or arbitrators as may be specified in the arbitration agreement. So once the conciliation proceedings fails, and parties they are agreeing that we would like to go for the voluntary arbitration, they will choose an independent person, right? And then matter would be forwarded for that purpose. And in other words, arbitration offers an opportunity for a solution of the dispute through the arbitrator jointly appointed by the parties to the dispute. And the process of arbitration saves time, money, both, and the parties, which is usually wasted in case of adjudication. So usually what happens when a matter goes to the labor court or for any adjudication purpose, so definitely then you will find that definitely there would be the wastage of money and time both. Both the parties, they would be just leaving the work where they are engaged, and they would be just going for the adjudication proceedings, and it's a lengthy process, time consuming process, and then parties are agreeing that we would like to resolve the issue with the help of arbitration, voluntary arbitration, and this process of arbitration will definitely save the times, will save the time and money of both the parties, which is usually wasted in case of adjudication also. And where an arbitration agreement provides for a reference of dispute to an even number of arbitrators, then the agreement shall provide for the appointment of another person as umpire, and who shall enter upon the reference if the arbitrators are equally divided in their opinion, and the award of the umpire shall prevail and shall be deemed to be the arbitration award for the purpose of this act. So my dear students, I would just repeat that where an arbitration agreement provides for the reference of the dispute to an even number of arbitrators, so there is a possibility that the agreement shall provide for the appointment of another, the reference of the dispute to an even number of arbitrators, and the agreement shall provide for the appointment of another person as umpire who shall enter upon the reference, because sometimes it might happen that arbitrators are equally divided in their opinion, and the award of the umpire shall prevail and shall be deemed to be arbitration award for the purpose of this act. And an arbitration agreement must be in prescribed manner and signed by the parties thereto. And an arbitration agreement referred in subsection 1, what I have told you right now, shall be in such form and shall be signed by the parties thereto in such manner as may be prescribed. And a copy of arbitration agreement shall be forwarded to the appropriate government as well, and the conciliation officer and the appropriate government shall within 1 month from the date of receipt of such copy publish the same in the official gazette also, within the one month time, as I told you. And where an industrial dispute has been referred to arbitration and appropriate government is satisfied that the persons making the reference represent the majority of each party, the appropriate government may, within the time referred in subsection 3, that I told you the 1 month, issue a notification in such manner as may be prescribed. And when any such notification is issued, the employers and the workmen who are not parties to the arbitration agreement but are concerned in the dispute, though they are not the parties but they are concerned in the dispute, shall be given an opportunity of presenting their case before the arbitrator or arbitrators. Though these employees and workmen are not the parties in that arbitration agreement, but they are somehow connected to the dispute or are concerned in the dispute. So this is again one more provision given. And the arbitrator or arbitrator shall investigate the dispute and submit to the appropriate government the arbitration award signed by the arbitrator or all the arbitrators as the case may be. So industrial dispute has been referred to the arbitration and notification has been issued, then wherein this industrial dispute has been referred to the arbitration and a notification has been issued, then under subsection 3A, the appropriate government may by order prohibit the continuance of any strike, lockout in connection with such dispute, which may be in existence on the date of the reference. And nothing in the Arbitration Act 1940 shall apply to arbitrations under this section. So these are certain provisions given under section 10A regarding the voluntary reference of dispute to the arbitration. And it's when the parties are willing to resolve the issue out of court, they do not want to go for the adjudication. So this is all about, my dear students, about the court of inquiry, and I've given you the overview of the voluntary reference of disputes to arbitration also. So I believe, I hope that this lecture will help you, and I believe that this lecture has made you comprehend about the. Thank you so much. Have a nice day. Have a nice time. Thank you.